You're traveling through the unknown, a journey beyond the corners of reality, where the shadows whisper and the chill runs deep. Welcome to the dimension where your deepest fears are given form. This is the Midnight Mystery.
The night was a tempest, the kind that rattled the old bones of Station 98.6 FM, nestled deep in the heart of rural New England. It was my last night, the final broadcast before the station would be shuttered for good, succumbing to the relentless march of progress and the digital age. I'd spent countless nights behind the mic, my voice a lone beacon in the dark for the insomniacs, the night owls, and the lost souls seeking solace in the wee hours. But tonight was different. The storm outside seemed almost personal, a cosmic send-off for a dying relic. "Alex, you sure you want to go through with this?" Sam's voice cut through the static of the pre-show jitters. My co-host and producer, a tech whiz with a penchant for the supernatural, was visibly unnerved. Sam had always been superstitious, claiming the station was cursed, haunted by the ghosts of tragedies past. "It's just another night, Sam. Besides, it's not like the ghosts are going to pack up and leave just because we are." I tried to sound more confident than I felt. The truth was, the station had always had an eerie vibe, especially at night. But I wasn't about to admit that now, not when we had a show to run. The clock struck midnight, and we went live. "Good evening, folks. This is Alex Mercer, and you're tuned into the last ever broadcast of Station 98.6 FM. It's a bittersweet night, and I'm here with Sam Rivera. Say hi, Sam." "Hi, folks. Let's make this a night to remember," Sam said, mustering a cheerful tone. But the cheer felt hollow, swallowed up by the storm raging outside. The first hour passed with the usual fare, dedicated songs, a couple of call-ins from regular listeners wishing us well. It was touching, really. Then came the call that changed everything. "Station 98.6 FM, you're on the air. What's your name and where are you calling from?" I asked, following protocol. A long pause. Then a voice, so cold it made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. "You shouldn't be there. It's coming for you." The line went dead. Sam and I exchanged uneasy glances. "Probably just a prank," I said, though my voice betrayed my fear. But the strange occurrences didn't stop there. Lights flickered erratically, casting shadows that seemed to move of their own volition. The temperature dropped, breaths materializing in the air. Unexplained noises echoed through the station, sounds that couldn't be rationalized as the building settling or the storm outside. "Alex, I don't like this. We should cut the broadcast and leave," Sam whispered, a tremor in his voice. "No, we have a show to finish. Besides, it's just a storm. Electrical issues and old building sounds, that's all," I lied, trying to convince myself as much as Sam. Then the caller phoned again. "You cannot hide. It knows you're there. It's always been there, waiting. And now, it's time." The line cut before I could respond. Panic set in. The atmosphere thickened with dread. Sam began to ramble about the local folklore, the cursed land on which the station was built, and the tragic events that had unfolded over the years. I wanted to dismiss it all as nonsense, but the fear gnawing at my gut told me otherwise. As the night progressed, the station seemed to come alive with malevolent energy. Shadows danced in the corners of my vision, whispers filled the airwaves, and an oppressive feeling of being watched settled over us. "We need to stick together, Alex. Whatever this is, we're in it together," Sam said, his voice barely above a whisper. "Yeah, together until the end," I replied, not realizing then how prophetic those words would be. As the night deepened, the storm outside seemed to mirror the chaos brewing within the walls of Station 98.6 FM. Sam and I huddled in the dimly lit broadcast room, the only source of warmth in a building that had suddenly turned cold and unwelcoming. The flickering lights and the eerie shadows played tricks on our eyes, but what came next was undeniably real. The caller, as we had dubbed our mysterious harasser, rang again. This time I answered with a hesitant, "Hello?" "You cannot escape its grasp. It has been awakened," the voice hissed, a sound so chilling it felt as though ice water had been poured down my spine.
"Who are you? What do you want from us?"
I demanded, my voice cracking with fear. But the line went dead, leaving us with more questions than answers.
"Alex, this isn't right. We're not alone here. Can't you feel it?"
Sam's voice was filled with terror, his usual skepticism drowned by the palpable fear that now consumed us both. I couldn't deny it any longer. The air was thick, charged with a malevolent energy that seemed to seep into my very bones. "Let's go through the archives," I suggested, hoping to find some explanation, some rational reason for the night's events. There has to be something, some clue as to what's happening. As we scoured the old records and tapes, the storm outside reached a fever pitch. The wind howled like a banshee, and for a moment, I wondered if we were listening to the storm or the cries of something not of this world. Then we found it, an old dusty tape labeled "Do Not Air." Curiosity overcame fear, and I loaded the tape into the player. The audio that filled the room was not of this world. A cacophony of whispers, screams, and something else. Something ancient and angry. The air grew colder, and the lights flickered more violently. "Turn it off, Alex! Turn it off!" Sam yelled. But I was frozen, unable to move as the sounds enveloped us. And then, silence. The room felt heavier, as if the air itself was pressing down on us. "What did we just unleash?" Sam whispered, his face pale in the flickering light. I had no answers, only a deep sinking feeling of dread. "We need to end this. Let's finish the broadcast and get out of here," I said, more to convince myself than Sam. But as we attempted to resume the show, the equipment malfunctioned, the screens displaying static and the microphones emitting a harsh, grating noise. It was as if the station itself was rejecting us. Then the shadows began to move. Not flickers this time, but clear, deliberate movements. Forms that were almost human but twisted, wrong in ways that made my stomach churn. "Alex, we're not alone," Sam said, his voice barely above a whisper. I could only nod, my throat tight with fear. The studio door slammed shut with a force that shook the walls, plunging us into darkness. The only light came from the eerie glow of the equipment screens, casting grotesque shadows across the room. And then they appeared. Figures, made of shadow and malice, circling us, whispering in a language that sounded ancient and deadly. "We need to fight," I said, though I had no idea how to combat shadows. Desperation led us to the only weapon we had, our broadcast. "Let's use the frequency. Maybe we can disrupt them, drive them away," Sam suggested, his voice trembling but determined. With shaking hands, I adjusted the dials, pushing the equipment to its limits. We needed a frequency, something powerful, something pure. The figures drew closer, their whispers growing louder, more insistent. I could feel their malice, their hunger. It was suffocating, consuming. And then, with a final twist of the dial, we unleashed a wave of sound through the speakers. It was a primal scream, a cry of defiance and hope in the face of utter despair. The effect was immediate. The figures recoiled, their forms dissolving into the air like smoke. The pressure lifted, and for a moment, we could breathe. But the relief was short-lived. The storm outside intensified, as if angered by our resistance. The building groaned under the force, and I knew we were far from safe. "We need to leave now," I said, grabbing Sam's arm. But the path to the door was not clear. The shadows lurked, waiting for us to make a move. It was now aware of us. Sam and I burst through the studio door, gasping for air as if we had been submerged underwater. The storm outside raged with renewed fury, a tangible manifestation of the chaos that had been unleashed within station 98.6 FM. Despite the danger that howled with the wind, it felt safer than the malevolence we had left behind in the broadcast room. "We can't just run, Alex. That thing, it's connected to the station, to us now," Sam said between ragged breaths, his eyes wide with a fear that mirrored my own. I nodded, my mind racing for solutions in a situation that defied logic. "The archives, the tape we played, there has to be a connection. We need to understand what we're dealing with if we're going to stand a chance." Armed with flashlights, we made our way to the station's heart, where decades of history lay entombed in records and old broadcasts. The storm seemed to follow us, the building creaking ominously as we delved deeper into the past. As we rifled through dusty boxes and ancient files, the truth began to unfold like a sinister tapestry. Station 98.6 FM had been built on ground tainted by tragedy and darkness. A series of unexplained disappearances and deaths linked back to broadcasts that were never supposed to air, rituals hidden in plain sight. "The entity," I whispered, the name a weight on my tongue. "It's not just haunting the station, it's bound to it, feeding on the fear and darkness." Sam found a journal, the ramblings of a former host who had dabbled in the occult, seeking to harness the entity for his own gain. But instead of control, he had found madness and a door that should have remained closed. "We need to close it, Alex. For good," Sam said, determination stealing his voice. I nodded, the plan forming in my mind. The broadcast. We'll use the station's own frequency against it, fight darkness with light. We set to work, piecing together the remnants of rituals and broadcasts, searching for a frequency that could act as a beacon of hope amidst the despair. It was a long shot, but it was all we had. The shadows watched us work, their presence a constant threat that slithered at the edge of our vision. But we pressed on, driven by the need to right a wrong that had festered in the heart of Station 98.6 FM for too long. Finally, we were ready. The equipment hummed to life, a beacon in the dark. I took a deep breath and spoke into the microphone, my voice steady despite the trembling in my hands. This is Alex Mercer, and you're listening to the final broadcast of Station 98.6 FM. Tonight, we face the darkness that has lurked within these walls, a darkness that has consumed too many. But we stand together, a light in the shadow, a voice in the silence. To those lost, to those afraid, know that you are not alone. Tonight, we banish the darkness. Together. The frequency surged, a symphony of light and sound that filled the station, the air vibrating with power. The entity, a formless malice that had hidden in the shadows, recoiled as the broadcast pierced the darkness. It was a battle of wills, a fight for the soul of Station 98.6 FM. The entity lashed out, the building shaking as if it would tear itself apart. But we held firm, our voices a mantra against the storm, and then silence. The storm abated, the darkness receded, and for a moment, there was peace. But our relief was short-lived. The silence was a harbinger, a pause before the final confrontation. The entity, though weakened, was not defeated. It gathered its strength, preparing for a final assault that would determine the fate of Station 98.6 FM and all who dared to stand against the darkness. As Sam and I stumbled out into the frigid night, the storm seemed to roar in defiance, as if angered by our escape from the shadows within Station 98.6 FM. The cold bit into our flesh, a stark contrast to the suffocating warmth of the haunted studio we'd left behind. But even as we sought refuge in the physical storm, we knew the real tempest raged on inside, fueled by something ancient and malevolent. Alex, we can't just leave it like this. It'll follow us, or worse, it'll latch onto anyone who dares enter that place again, Sam said through chattering teeth, his eyes wide with a mix of fear and determination. He was right. The entity we'd awoken wasn't bound by walls or geography. It was unleashed, unfettered, and if we didn't find a way to bind it again, the consequences would be dire. We need to go back, I said, the words tasting like ash in my mouth. We need to end this, once and for all. Sam nodded, and together we made our way back to the station, the wind howling around us like the cries of the damned. Inside, the building was eerily silent, the chaotic energy that had pervaded it before now replaced with a waiting, watchful stillness. It was as if the entity knew we were back, as if it was inviting us to try our luck again. We need a plan, Sam whispered, pulling out schematics of the station from his backpack. There's an old transmitter in the basement, from the early days of the station. It's powerful, more powerful than anything we have up here. If we can modify it, use it to broadcast a counter-frequency. His voice trailed off as the reality of our plan set in. It was a long shot, a desperate gambit that relied on technology and a bit of arcane knowledge we barely understood. But it was all we had. The journey to the basement was a descent into madness. Every step echoed unnaturally, as if we were walking not on concrete but on the bones of those who'd come before us. Shadows flickered at the edge of our vision, always just out of sight, and whispers filled the air, taunting, threatening. But we pushed on, driven by a need to end the nightmare we'd become a part of. The old transmitter was exactly as Sam had described it, a behemoth of tubes and wires, dormant but still imposing. Working together, we began the task of modifying it, repurposing the ancient technology for our needs. Sam's knowledge of the supernatural, combined with my experience in broadcasting, created a makeshift weapon, a beacon of hope in the darkness. As we worked, the entity made its presence known. The air grew thick, heavy with the scent of decay and old blood. Figures appeared, more solid than before, their eyes hollow pits of despair and hunger. They circled us, a pack of predators waiting for the moment to strike. We're running out of time, Alex, Sam said, his voice steady despite the terror that clawed at the edges of his words. "Just a few more adjustments," I replied, my fingers flying over the ancient dials and switches. And then it was ready. The entity surged forward as we powered up the transmitter, a tidal wave of darkness intent on snuffing out our light. But we were ready. I grabbed the microphone, and with a voice that carried the weight of our desperation and hope, I spoke. "This is Alex Mercer and Sam Rivera, broadcasting live from station 98.6 FM. To whatever listens in the darkness, hear us now. You are not welcome here. This is our final stand." The words were a catalyst, igniting the energy we'd harnessed. The transmitter roared to life, sending out a counter frequency that cut through the darkness like a blade. The figures screamed, their forms dissolving as the light from the transmitter banished them. But the entity itself was a different beast. It fought back, a maelstrom of hatred and malice that threatened to overwhelm us. The station shook to its foundations, the very air charged with the power of the unseen battle. "We need more power," Sam yelled, adjusting the dials frantically. I joined him, pouring every ounce of our energy into the transmitter. The light grew brighter, the frequency sharper, until with a final, ear-splitting crack, the darkness shattered. Silence fell, heavy and absolute. We'd done it, or so we hoped, or so we. The dawn was silent, a stark contrast to the cacophony of the night before. Sam and I trudged through the snow, the station's ruins casting long shadows in the early light. We had survived, yes, but at what cost? The silence was unnerving, as if the storm and the entity had taken the world's noise with them when they vanished. "Alex, do you think it's really over?" Sam's voice was low, almost lost in the vast quiet that surrounded us. I glanced back at the skeletal remains of station 98.6 FM, an uneasy feeling settling in my stomach. "I don't know, Sam. I don't know if something like that can ever be truly over." We reached the edge of the forest, the first rays of the sun filtering through the trees, casting eerie patterns on the snow. That's when we heard it, a faint whisper, carried on the wind, almost imperceptible. "Did you hear that?" I stopped, straining my ears. Sam nodded, his face pale. "It sounded like the broadcast. Impossible. The station was destroyed, the equipment in ruins. Yet, as we stood there, the whispers grew louder, forming words, a message repeating over and over. You cannot silence what has been awakened." The realization hit me with the force of a physical blow. The entity wasn't bound to the station. It was bound to the broadcast, to the frequency we had unleashed. And in our attempt to destroy it, we had set it free. "We need to warn people," Sam said, panic edging his voice. "But how? The station was gone, and with it our only means of broadcasting, and who would believe us? Two survivors of a night of horror, with nothing but wild tales of ancient entities and cursed broadcasts. We have to try," I insisted, though doubt clouded my mind. The world needed to know, to be prepared for whatever might come next. We made our way back to civilization, our minds reeling with plans and warnings. But as we reached the outskirts of town, we realized something was terribly wrong. The silence followed us, oppressive and complete. No birds chirped, no cars moved along the roads. The town lay still, as if frozen in time. And everywhere, from the open windows of houses, from the abandoned cars on the street, came the sound of a broadcast, a soft, whispering voice that chilled the blood. You cannot silence what has been awakened. The entity hadn't just escaped, it had spread, carried by the very frequency we had hoped would be its demise. It was everywhere, infecting the airwaves, seeping into the minds of every living soul. Sam and I exchanged a look of horror. We had thought to end a nightmare, but instead, we had unleashed it upon the world. As we walked through the silent town, the full magnitude of our actions weighed heavily on us. We had become the harbingers of a horror beyond comprehension, a darkness that spread like a plague through the very fabric of reality. And then, as we stood in the center of the silent town, the broadcast changed. No longer content with mere whispers, it grew louder, more insistent. Join us. The air around us shimmered, the world bending, twisting into impossible shapes. Figures emerged from the shadows, their eyes voids of despair and malice, their whispers a siren call to join them in the darkness. Sam and I ran, but it was futile. The entity had the world in its grasp, and there was nowhere to hide, nowhere to escape to. As the figures closed in, the last thing I heard was the voice from the broadcast, a mockery of our final attempt to fight back. The last broadcast of station 98.6 FM will now be forever. And then, darkness. In our quest to silence a nightmare, we had become part of it, our actions the final note in a symphony of horror that would play out across the world. The last broadcast was not an end, but a beginning, a dark and horrific twist in a tale of human folly and ancient evils awakened. As the entity consumed us, I realized the true horror was not in being hunted or haunted, but in becoming the very thing we had sought to destroy. And in the silent, shadowed world that the entity had claimed, our voices would whisper alongside the others, a never-ending broadcast of despair and darkness. That's a wrap for today on the Midnight Mystery. Hope you guys had as much fun as we did. If you liked what you saw, hit that subscribe button and give us a thumbs up. Oh, and don't be shy. Drop a comment below with your thoughts or any cool mystery ideas you want us to check out. Until next time, we'll see you in the next Midnight Mystery.